वाला मेमोरियल नेशनल टैक्स वर्चुअल मूट कोर्ट कंपटीशन 2021। आई एम अमृता एंड आई एम गोइंग टू बी द कोर्ट क्लर्क फॉर दिस राउंड। TC17 विल बी द एपेलेंट्स एंड TC07 विल बी द रेस्पोंडेंट्स फॉर दिस राउंड। इफ द जजेस आर कंफर्टेबल एंड गुड टू गो, वी विल बिगिन विद द सेशन।
Yes.
थैंक यू जजेस। I request all the participants to turn on your video and have yourself on mute. TC17, Speaker 1 will now proceed with the submission and will be taking 24 minutes.
Greetings, Your Lordship. We are the counsel on behalf of the appellants, and Your Lordship, I am the Speaker 1 and I'll be dealing with the first and second issue. And my co-counsel speaker, first, second, third issue, my co-counsel speaker 2 will be dealing with the fourth and the fifth issue, Your Lordships. Is Your Lordship well versed with the facts of the case?
Yes.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the counsel seeks permission to begin with the arguments.
Yes.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, firstly, the counsel on behalf of the appellants are humbly contend before this honorable court that the exemption, that the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal was not correct in denying the entire exemption under Section 11 due to attractions of provisions of Section 13, Subsection 1 and Section 13, Subsection 2. Your Lordship, in the present case, the appellant trust has been denied the exemption of Section 11 and through a combined reading of Section 13, Subsection 1, Clause C, Subclause 2, with Section 13, Subsection 2, Clause B, and Section 13, Subsection 3, Clause B, Your Lordships, it has been stated that in the case of a charitable trust, any income, if any part of income or property is applied to the benefit of a person who has made a substantial contribution of rupees 50,000 or more, then Your Lordship, the provisions of Section 13 will apply, and Section 11, Your Lordship, it does not apply, and the exemption under Section 11 would not be available to the assess, Your Lordship. That has been stated by the respondent. But Your Lordship, in the present facts of the case, the appellant trust, which is the Learn More Educational Trust, Your Lordship, is receiving donations of rupees 5 lakh and rupees 3 lakh from SK and RK Trust. But Your Lordship, as has been contended by the respondent and as well as the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal, as the rent has not been charged for the administrative office of SK and RK Trust in the appellant's building, that is why a benefit is accruing to those two trusts, and therefore the income under Section 11 would not be exempt due to the attraction of provisions of Section 13. But Your Lordship, the counsel on behalf of the appellants humbly contend before you that even if the rent would have been charged, Your Lordship, there would have been no benefit accruing to the SK Trust and RK Trust. In the present case, Your Lordship, the SK Trust and RK Trust, as stated, have their administrative office in the buildings of the appellate, and Your Lordship, they are giving an amount of 5 lakhs and 8 lakhs as donations. Your Lordship, if Your Lordship, the donations are that have been made by SK Trust and RK Trust are already deductible under Section 80G, subclause 2, clause subsection 2, clause A, subclause 4, and Your Lordship, in the present case, rent has not been charged. But if the rent would have been charged, Your Lordship, it would have been allowed as an expense under Section 30 of the Income Tax Act, which goes to show, Your Lordship, that the no benefit has been is
how
accruing.
How do you say it is deductible?
Deductible.
Your Lordship. Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the appellant trust, which is the Learn More Educational Trust, firstly, is registered under Section 80G of the Income Tax Act. Therefore, any contribution or donation which is made to the trust would person making
such question donation... was his question was, had the interest been credited, how it was deductible? That was the question.
When the rent is collected, it's an income in your hands. See, if you've charged rent on these two entities, whatever made on the SK and RK,
much obliged.
That will be an income to the trust. So how is it deductible?
In Your Lordship, Section 13 talks about the benefit which is accruing to SK and RK Trust. Your Lordship, it is the current exemption has been denied on the basis that SK and RK Trust are receiving a benefit on the basis that no rent has been charged from them.
Correct.
So, Your Lordship, if the Lordship, the donations that SK and RK Trust are paying would have been allowed under Section 80G. But Your Lordship, the fact is that SK and RK Trust have their administrative office in the buildings of the appellant. Therefore, the rent which is being which would have been paid under that administrative office would have been allowed as an expense under the chapter of PGBP under section 30, which talks about the allowance of rent as an expense, Your Lordship. In either case, if the rent had been charged or if the rent would not have been charged, no benefit would have accrued to SK Trust and RK Trust, Your Lordship. This is what.
So, are you saying the impugned trust is a lessee or a tenant in the building of RK or SK? Are RKSK or the tenants here?
Why is it?
If these two entities are a tenant here, then the impugned trust will only receive income. They should have charged, which they didn't.
Indeed.
Okay, fine. No, I'm just parking the question. You can take your time. You go to the next issue.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the council would humbly submit that even if the exemption under section 11 is if exemption is denied, the entire exemption on the entire income as has been denied by the CC by the respondent should not be denied. Your Lordship, firstly, the council would like to bring the attention of Your Lordship to section 13, which subsection 1, which says that section 11 and section 12 should not apply so as to exclude from the total income. And then Your Lordship, section 1 clause C states that any income thereof. This goes to show, Your Lordship, that the intention of the legislature was to make sure that in case of the attraction of provision of section 13, not the entire exemption, but only the amount which is being accruing as a benefit should be denied as an exemption. Further, Your Lordship, the council would like to cite section 164 subsection 2, which states that the words used in those sections are the relevant part of income which is not exempt under section 11 due to attractions of section 13, provision of section 13 would be subject to tax. Further, Your Lordship, the council would like to present the case of Director of Income Tax versus Sheth Mafatlal Gagalbhai, which it was held that only the non-exempt income would fall in the net of tax as if it was the income of association of persons. Further, Your Lordship, the council would like to put forward the case of Commissioner of Income Tax Pune versus Audyogik Shikshan Mandal, in which it was held that on a plain reading of section 11 and 13 of the Act, it is clear that the legislature did not contemplate the denial of the entire benefit, the denial of benefit of section 11 of the Act to the entire income of the trust, as such a denial will lead to grave.
Counsel, one question.
Much obliged.
There are two issues to it. You can go slow. Be very slow. You are very methodical. Go slow. Don't worry. Okay.
Much obliged, Your Lordship.
See, there are two aspects to it. One is allocation. Another is denial. If it is found to be a breach, if we feel that there is a breach, then why should we apply theory of proportionality? Because in tax law, it's not subject to the principle of reasonableness. Tax law, you are either here or not there. So we can always say that because you disqualify because of your ineligibility, the whole exemption can be denied. What is wrong about it?
Indeed, Your Lordship, as stated by the language of section 13, as put forward by the council, section 13 states that section 11 and section 12 should not apply so as to exclude from the total income any income thereof if part of property is applied to the benefit of a person. That's the language of section 13, Your Lordship. Further, as the council was citing the case of CIT exemptions Pune versus Audyogik Shikshan Mandal, Your Lordship, in this case, it was held by the Honorable Bombay High Court that on a plain reading of section 11 and 13 of the Act, it is clear that the legislature did not contemplate the denial of benefit of section 11 to the entire income of the trust, as such a denial would lead to grave injustice as the consequences of any mistake and or misdemeanor involving a small amount would lead to denial of benefit of exemption to the entire income otherwise admittedly used for charitable purposes. Further, Your Lordships, in the case of Mysore Minerals Limited versus Commissioner of Income Tax, it was held that it is well settled that where there are two possible interpretations of a taxing provision, the one which is favorable to the SSE should be preferred.
After Dilip, no, you can't apply that anymore.
Yeah, it is not applicable anymore. As he rightly pointed out, after the Dilip Kumar judgment, the SSE does not get that benefit. More occurrence is whether it is probable or not, either this way or that way. There cannot be a via media way. Anyway, that's all. Carry on.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the council seeks permission to move on to the next issue.
Yes.
Your Lordship, the council on behalf of the appellants humbly submit that the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal was not correct in holding that the amount of rupees 30 lakhs which was spent towards the construction of a community canteen your lordships, was an act which was in violation of the terms of the trust. Firstly, your lordship, the council would humbly submit before this honorable court that section 12 AA, that the registration of the trust under section 12 AA subsection 3 has not been revoked. Your lordships, section 12 AA subsection 3 of the Income Tax Act states that if the commissioner or the principal commissioner, which
that's
in
the
this
question case, then counsel, that's the question. See, a revocation would come when the breach is total. Now, you are doing your educational activity within the framework of your charitable objectives. Now you have put your money of 30 lakhs on possibly a charitable purposes, which we don't deny, but not falling within the objectives of the trust. So denial of the 30 lakhs benefit, why should we cancel your registration? We are dealing this 30 lakhs separately. Where is the need? If you have done a mistake on your educational objectives, then 12AA has to be recalled. But when your objective, principal objective is not found to be at fault, your other objective does not find place as an objective. In such cases, why should that point be done? Why should we cancel your registration? You continue, we'll disallow this. The tribunal has only upheld the disallowance. It has not held you to be a bad trust.
Indeed.
What's wrong?
Indeed, Your Lordship, as stated, Your Lordship, the words used in subsection 12, double section 3 are if the commissioner of income tax or the principal commissioner is satisfied that the activities are not being carried out in consonance with the objects of the trust, Your Lordship.
You are doing the activities in consonance, but you are far exceeding the consonance. You are going beyond. It is not that you stopped education and you diverted funds. Then you are right. You are carrying out your objective, but also diverting 30 lakhs. Yes, sir.
No, because he is driving the point that the tribunal cannot say that merely because it is used for the purpose of floods, it can be denied. Therefore, he is allowing him at this stage to continue. Otherwise, he drives at that point. He wants to establish.
Let him.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the council would then humbly state that if the activities are considered not to be in consonance with the objects, the activities are to be considered as an allied charitable activity. That is, the amount of 30 lakhs which is spent towards the construction of a community canteen is to be considered as an allied charitable activity. Your Lordship, the council would like to humbly submit before you the case for the benefit of poor actors and artists spent a certain amount for purchase of leasehold rights, which would be used to serve the cause of general public in times of floods. The amount spent by SSC was to be considered an application of income within the meaning of section 11 subsection 1 clause A, Your Lordships.
This will satisfy incidental, because the principal objective is also serving that cause, whereas your principal cause is education. Charity to poor is also one of the seven objectives under 250, the definition of charitable institution, but it is not aligned with education. Therefore, should you amend or not amend?
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the objects of the trust firstly state that it includes the creation of schools for students with special needs. And second objective of Lordship is for creation of vocational training centers and learning centers for unemployed youth, Your Lordship. Which goes to show that there is an element of general public utility in the objects of the trust, which goes to show, Your Lordship, that the amount which was spent, of the amount of 30 lakhs which was spent, could be considered as an allied charitable activity. And further, Your Lordships, it was held in Commissioner of Income Taxes.
Whether it could be or should be your question.
Your Lordship, the councils of the behalf of the appellate should be considered.
One minute, His Lordship is asking a question. Please.
Yeah. No, whether it could be is cannot be there. Whether it is could be or should be.
Should be.
Your Lordship, it should be considered as an application, as an allied charitable activity. Further, Your Lordships, in Commissioner of Income Tax versus JK Charitable Trust, it was held that a charitable purpose may be served in more than one way. Further, the council...
No doubt. Provided your objectives... See, it's like this. You can either say it's merely form, or you can say that it is substance. Charitable institution has to go by the doctrine of substance. We are going to put the same question to the other side also. Don't worry. So,
whether you trying to get the maximum out of you. That's it.
So, whether you go by form or substance, see, all your memorials are all well written both sides. So, we just wanted to test you a little more. That's all.
Much obliged. Your Lordship, the council once again puts forward the contention that as there's an element of general public utility in the objects of the trust, which this is why the application of income of 30 lakhs towards the construction of community canteen should also come under the ambit of the objects of the trust. Further, Your Lordships, the council would also like to submit, if these activities are not considered to be allied charitable activities, then the application of 30 lakhs towards the construction of community canteen is to be treated as a notional amendment towards the objects of the trust. Your Lordships, in the case of direct...
No, I mean, notional means deemed. Where is the provision? We are ready to deem. Give us, where is the provision to say you can deem?
Your Lordship, indeed, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the council would like to cite the case of Director of Income Tax versus Ramoji Foundation and would support that with facts. Your Lordship, in the present case, the settler is the sole trustee of the appellant trust. Now, Your Lordship, it has been held in Director of Income Tax versus Ramoji Foundation that when the power has been given by the settler to the trustee, the trust deed, which is registered under Section 12AA, can be amended without approaching the civil court, provided that the conditions laid down by the settler are fulfilled. As stated, Your Lordships, in this case, the settler is the sole trustee, and as Your Lordships, the amount which was spent, Your Lordship, was spent with the bona fide intention to be considered within the objects of the trust. But Your Lordship,
it's a good point. Where do you get in the fact that the settler is the sole trustee? Is it an admitted fact?
Much obliged, Your Lordship. The fact is mentioned in the Your Lordships, in the moot proposition, Your Lordship, that the settler, Mr. Aryan, is the sole trustee of the Learnmore Educational Trust.
Okay. Carry on, please carry on.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. The council would seek permission to move on to the next.
Lordships can give consent. I think his Lordship is disconnected.
Lordships,
apologies to interrupt. I guess the TC017 speaker one is facing some technical issue. Judges, can we wait for a minute for him to join back? Thank you, judges.
Oh, it's a sole trustee. Yeah, it's an admitted fact. Correct. Yeah. But we have to wait for his Lordships.
Indeed, judges, we will wait for...
Yes, sir.
Much of like Lordship, the council seeks permission to move on to the next issue.
Yes, yes, please.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordships, the council, on behalf of the appellants, humbly contend that the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal was not correct in denying the exemption under Section 11, Subsection 1, Clause D, and that the appellant was correct in treating the amount of rupees 75 lakhs, which was donated, which was contributed by Reliance as part of the corpus. Your Lordships, in the present case, Reliance Industries Limited has contributed an amount, voluntarily contributed an amount of rupees 75 lakhs to the appellant trust. Your Lordships, the council would like to bring your attention to the case of Director of Income Tax Bangalore versus Sri Ramakrishna Seva Ashram, where it was held that the word corpus is used in the context of Income Tax Act. We have to understand the same as in the context of the capital of a trust. Therefore, Lordship, if any voluntary contribution is made with a specific direction, then it shall be treated as part of the corpus. But Your Lordships, it was also held in this case that it is not necessary that a voluntary contribution should be made with a specific direction to treat it as part of the corpus.
Counsel, there's one question. 1 minute. Suppose this trust has chosen to spend 75 lakhs in the same year. Are they entitled to do it or not?
Well, Lordships, could you please repeat the question?
No, you have chosen. Sorry, sir. Sir, you want to ask?
Can you please continue?
Now, see, there are two options. You collected 75 lakhs and donor says you do whatever you want to do. So you could have spent 75 lakhs in the first year itself. Nobody could have questioned it. Now, therefore, the doubt that is arising in the mind of the tax officers, when there is ambiguity, whether you can spend it in the same year or put it into corpus, the discretion is always with the donor and not with the donee under the Act. So how did you choose to put it into a corpus without a consent from the donor? That's the point.
Indeed, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the council would answer this question by completing the case that the council was citing. Lordship, it was held in this case that if the intention of the donor is to give the money to a trust, which they will keep in a trust account and deposit, and the income from the same is utilized for carrying on a particular activity, it satisfies the definition part of the corpus.
Wow.
And
in fact, it can also be held against you. The intention of the donor, how do you say that it is meant to be kept only as a deposit in terms of a corpus? That's why we asked you a question. Do you have the discretion to spend it in the same year or not? You have to give an answer to that.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Lordship, the council was going to answer that question. Your Lordship, as per the facts of the case, at the time of donation, Your Lordship, there was no direction from Reliance Industries Limited regarding to the treatment of the trust. But Your Lordship, the endowment fund was created in the name of Reliance Industries Limited, which is to act as a subsequent confirmation. And Your Lordship, as through the case which has been cited by the council on behalf of the appellants,
that's good. Very good. Now, one minute. Very good. Now, how do you say there's a subsequent confirmation? It's a good point.
Your Lordship, an endowment fund in the name of Reliance Industries Limited could not be created without the confirmation of Reliance Industries, Your Lordship.
No, you are creating at your end. You can create in anybody's name. You can create in your name also.
But
it is good because, yes, see, that money has come out of their fund. It has come to you. You have chosen to recognize it in their name. Suppose you have kept it in ABC, is a company, 75 lakhs, or ABC deposit. Where is the restriction? As long as this money is, after it fell into your account, you are designating its status. What's the problem?
Stated by the facts of the present situation as well as the case that has been cited by the council, Your Lordships, if the amount is to be kept in a trust account in deposit, Your Lordship, in the case, it was held in an endowment fund in a fixed deposit with the nationalized bank, Your Lordship, and the income from the same was utilized for the satisfaction of the charitable purpose of the appellant, then the exemption under Section 11, Subsection 1, Clause D was allowed, Your Lordship, in the case that has been cited. In the present case, Your Lordship, the factual circumstances are similar as the amount was kept as stated in an endowment fund in the trust in the name of Reliance Industries Limited. Your Lordship, the creation of endowment fund requires a confirmation of some sort from Reliance Industries Limited. And after that, the amount being kept in a fixed deposit, the interest from the same was used for satisfaction of the objects of the trust, Your Lordship.
Your this pleading is why page 27 goes on the presumption that there is a confirmation. We just wanted to know whether on facts there is a confirmation.
Your
pleading in paragraph 40 at page 27 says there is a subsequent confirmation by them. Now, what are the proofs that they have confirmed?
Your Lordship, the council would like to cite a case that is in the case of CID Central Circle Bangalore versus Bhatiya Sanskriti Vidyapeeth Trust, where it was written that in the absence of any writing, only means to find out as to what is the direction can be gathered by considering how the recipient of the amount has accounted for it.
Correct.
This goes to show, Your Lordship, the fact that the recipient of the amount acted in that manner goes to show that there was a confirmation from Reliance Industries Limited to treat the amount of contribution in that manner, Your Lordship. That is why the creation of the endowment fund in Reliance's name, along with the case that has been cited, Your Lordship, these two arguments put forward the contention that there was a subsequent confirmation from Reliance Industries. Your Lordship, the council, my co-counsel will be proceeding with the next two issues. It was an honor arguing before this honorable court.
Good. Yes, the next person can proceed.
Greetings to the honorable bench.
I would just like to mention the time that TC 17 speaker 2 will be taking. He'll be taking 16 minutes, judges. Thank you.
Greetings to the honorable bench. I am the co-counsel appearing from the side of the respondent in the present case, and the present counsel would be dealing with issue number 4 and issue number 5 in the present case. Your Lordships, the council seeks permission to proceed towards issue number 4.
Yes.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, issue number 4 in the present case deals with that the amount spent in conducting the cultural event at Singapore is to be treated as an application of income and hence liable to be exempted under Section 11, Subsection 1, Clause A, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, in this issue, the council would be submitting that the amount spent in cultural event at Singapore was an application of income for charitable purposes of the applicant in India, and the sum of rupees 75 lakhs spent on the same shall be exempted under the said section, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, in the present case, as mentioned in paragraph number 9 of the moot proposition, in financial year 15-16, the Appellant Trust for the first time conducted an event outside India. For the initiative was taken for the fundraiser event to showcase the talent of children studying in their school. Your Lordship, in the present situation, the amount of rupees 75 lakh spent on the cultural event are in question and hence denied exemption by the ITAT. Your Lordship,
one simple question: can you spend 75 lakhs outside India and claim a benefit for an Indian trust?
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, for this purpose, I would like to refer to the Bayer Act under Section 11, Subsection 1, Clause A. Your Lordship, the line reads: to the extent to which such income is applied to such purposes in India, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the word applied has been used, Your Lordship, and the council in the present issue is contending that the word spend and apply do not necessarily have the same meaning, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, if the legislation would have to use spend in the said provision, it would have used the word spent in the said section, Your Lordship. But the word apply, Your Lordship, in the present situation.
See, that is the reason. No, that reason is, in a trust, there is no income and expenditure. You don't put a profit and loss. In a trust, it is expenditure is always in the form of an application. No problem. You're right. The question is, when you apply it, can you apply it? Is there a compulsion you should apply it within the country? That's, I think, right? I mean, whether within the country or outside. You have spent it in Singapore and you are getting donations.
Your Lordship, could you please pardon?
You're not hearing us?
Are you not able to hear?
Judges, I'm sorry. I think TC 17 speaker 2 is having some technical issue. His video and audio are paused. With your permission, can we wait for 2 more minutes?
Yes, yes.
Thank you, Judge.
Sorry for the disturbance, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, could you please pardon?
No. Application, no problem. Now, can you apply a fund outside India and also generate a fund outside India for a trust which is otherwise a registered Indian trust?
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the application of the amount in question has been done within the territory of India, Your Lordship, only. The amount has been spent outside the territory of India, Your Lordship, and the honorable.
Are you saying 75 lakhs were spent in India?
Indeed, not, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the 75 lakhs in question have been spent outside India, Your Lordship, but the application of those 75 lakhs are within the territory of India. Your Lordship. Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the council would like to answer to Your Lordship's question in the further arguments, Your Lordship.
Unless otherwise you say, for the purpose of Income Tax Act, India includes Singapore.
Indeed not, Your Lordship.
No, according, if you were to understand, see, you want to say, though the amount was spent there, ultimately, the benefit has come to India. Is that what you want to mean now?
Indeed, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the amount has been spent outside, yes, India, in Singapore, for organizing the event, Your Lordship, the objective, the purpose of this event was fundraising, Your Lordship, and the purpose would be fulfilled after the said donations will be brought to India, Your Lordship.
That's why this question was, very clear. Whether you are permitted to take such an event outside and thereby collect money, that you are being a trust in India.
Because,
indeed, Your Lordship.
Because this case you earned another 75 lakhs more, very well. Suppose you have incurred 75 lakhs and did not earn any money, whether the 75 lakhs would be allowed or not?
Indeed, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, in the present case, the expenditure of 75 lakhs can be done outside the territory of India. Your Lordship, for this, I would like to proceed towards my further arguments, if Your Lordship permits. Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the word applied does not necessarily mean spent. And Your Lordship, in the present case, the event organized was in Singapore and the amount can be said to have been spent in Singapore, but cannot be said to have been applied in Singapore, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, applied, Your Lordship, the council would like to refer to to a case in this situation. The Honorable Court, in the case of CIT versus Thanti Trust, Your Lordship, relying upon the judgment of Supreme Court, relying upon a Supreme Court judgment of Nizam's Trust versus CIT, held that the expression applied occurring in Section 11 meant that the income was actually applied for charitable and religious purposes, and not and the mere crediting will not amount to the application as contemplated under as contemplated by Section 11, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the amount.
Possibly you can nuance it little to say, even though we have spent it in Singapore to generate it, ultimately net the benefit is going to be only applied in India for the benefit of those who are educating in India.
Indeed, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the purpose of this fundraiser was
for which you should need an FCNR account, yeah. Otherwise, you can't bring $1 in India.
But an Indian trust
can do, provided it has an FCNR account. Facts are not clear, therefore, we'll give you the benefit. No problem.
Okay. Indeed, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, as the council was saying, that the amount was spent out in Singapore, Your Lordship, but since the purpose of this charitable event was to collect donations for the object of the trust, Your Lordship, the purpose will be fulfilled within when the donations will be brought in India, Your Lordship. Therefore, Your Lordship, the amount of 75 lakhs which have been spent in Singapore, the final application of that amount will be done in the taxable territory, Your Lordship. To conclude with this argument, Your Lordship, the council would like to say that the amount of 75 lakhs which was spent by the appellant trust in Singapore is definitely an application of income in India, Your Lordship, and therefore shall be granted exemption to the amount of 75 lakhs, Your Lordship. With Your Lordship's permission, the council would now like to proceed towards issue number 5 in the present case. Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, issue number 5 in the present case is that the Honorable ITAT was incorrect in holding that the income accumulated by the appellant would be taxable, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, in this particular issue, the council would be putting forward that the amount of 1 crore which was accumulated by the appellant in financial year 2008 and 2009 would not be taxable and shall be granted exemption to the entire amount. Your Lordship, this argument, this particular issue is based on the assertion that the income accumulated was put into use for the purpose of the accumulated accumulation, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, as mentioned,
purpose is being correct. There is no problem in suspecting the purpose.
Indeed, Your Lordship.
No doubt. But how do you say it is 10 years and not 5 years? There is some doubt there.
Indeed, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, as per the grounds of appeal, Your Lordship, the grounds of appeal in the present situation, Your Lordship, as mentioned in paragraph number F of the moot proposition, the grounds of appeal for the particular issue in the present situation is the purpose for the accumulation. Also, Your Lordship, as mentioned by the assessing officer in the present situation, which is mentioned in the moot proposition, paragraph number 17, point G, Your Lordship, as per the assessing officer, the accumulated income was not spent for the purpose for which it was accumulated within the prescribed time limit, Your Lordship.
So you mean to say, even without the purpose, suppose if it is accumulated, it is okay. His question was very clear. The question is only utilization within a period of 5 years or not.
Indeed.
The limitation is a prescribed time. How do you expect to say?
Indeed, Your Lordship.
Whether it is for the purpose or of the purpose, can you do that?
Indeed, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, even if considering that the assessing officer meant that the time period was not, that the time period has been extended in the present situation, Your Lordship, to that, the council would like to put forward that the income accumulated would be treated as per the provisions of IT Act as it stood amended in the 2009 amendment, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, in 2009 amendment, a trust was allowed to accumulate a particular sum of income for a maximum period of 10 years, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the maximum period was...
Which is the provision? Which says 10 years?
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, this was the provision as per the Income Tax Act of 2009, after the 2009 amendment, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, since the appellants have accumulated the sum of income in the year 2008 and 2009, therefore, the provisions of IT Act after the 2009 amendment would be applicable in the present case. Your Lordship, in 2015, the said provision was amended and the maximum prescribed time limit was converted to 5 years. But Your Lordship, by the year 2015 could furnish a written statement to the assessing officer for the purpose and time limit wherein the maximum time limit could be up to 10 years, Your Lordship. The applicability of the 2005 amendment was came into the existence in the assessing year 2016 and 17, Your Lordship.
Are you saying, in spite of the amendment in 2015, AO is vested with a discretion in a given case to extend it to 5 more years? Is that your point?
Indeed, not, Your Lordship.
Then the statute operates.
Your Lordship, the statute will be, which will be applicable to the appellants in the present case, would be the statute which came into existence after the 2009.
Because you say it's a vested right.
Indeed, Your Lordship. After 2009 amendment, Your Lordship, which allows us to accumulate up to 10 years, Your Lordship. Therefore, Your Lordship, the time period in the present situation cannot be said to have been completed after the 5 years, Your Lordship. Moreover, Your Lordship, the purpose of the accumulation is clearly stated in the statement of fact that the appellant trust accumulated the sum of 1 crore for the construction of school building, Your Lordships. Construction was commenced in 2015 May and was completed by February 2016. Your Lordship, the entire amount of 1 crore was utilized towards the construction of the school building, and therefore the purpose in the present case can also not be challenged.
For which, see, we are again, as His Lordship was saying even 5 minutes ago, we are not suspecting your purpose. If you exceed the time limit and still subserve the purpose, is there a provision in the law to condone it? That's the question.
Your Lordship.
Yeah, we agree with your purpose, but have you done it within time?
Although the time limit applicable in the present situation will be 10 years, up to 10 years. But answering to Your Lordship's question, there is a provision in the statute under section 11, subsection 2, which says that in case the time limit has been extended, the exemption shall be granted when there is an order or injunction by the court, Your Lordships. But yeah, Your Lordship, in the present
state, that is when it gets stayed.
Indeed, Your Lordship.
You are saying the dispute, because of the dispute, it got stayed. So that period has to be excluded.
Your Lordship, the council.
Land right dispute, now, because of the land dispute.
Your Lordship, the council is contending that the time period has not been extended in the present situation, Your Lordship, because the provisions which were applicable was the 2009 amended provisions, Your Lordship, which grants us which permits us to accumulate for a period up to 10 years, Your Lordship.
All right.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, concluding this argument, the council would like to say, the council would humbly like to put forward that the accumulated amount of 1 crore in the present situation was utilized for the purpose it was accumulated for, and also the time period has not been extended in the present situation, and therefore the exemption on this 1 crore shall be granted to the appellant trust, Your Lordship. If Your Lordships permit, now the council would like to move forward towards the prayer.
You know the prayer, you want the circuit to be allowed.
Indeed, Your Lordship.
With cost or without cost is a discretion.
Well done.
Indeed, Your
Lordship. Yes, good.
It was a pleasure arguing before the bench.
Yes.
For the respondent?
Judges, I would like to mention that team TC07, both the speakers will be taking 21 minutes each. Thank you. You may proceed.
At the outset, I'd like to confirm I'm audible and visible.
Yes, very well.
Greetings to the bench. If it may please this honorable court, this is the counsel on behalf of the respondent, the Commissioner of Income Tax, in the case of Learn More Educational Trust versus Commissioner of Income Tax. I will be dealing with issues 1 and 2, while my co-counsel will be dealing with the rest of the issues raised in the present case. We shall speak for 21 minutes each, and we respectfully reserve 3 minutes for Sarabhatu. The counsel seeks permission to address the bench collectively as your lordships.
Yes, permission.
Much obliged, your lordship. If your lordships are satisfied with the facts of the case, the counsel seeks permission to proceed to the issues at hand.
Yes, directly go to the issue.
Much obliged, your lordship. Proceeding to the first issue, it is our contention that the Honorable ITAT was correct in concluding that the entire exemption under Section 11 would not be available if the provisions of Section 13.1 read with Section 13.2 were retracted. I shall prove this in a twofold manner. That firstly, the appellant was in clear violation of Section 13 of the Act due to the usage of trust property without charging rentals. And secondly, such violation of Section 13 should inadvertently result in the denial of entire exemption under Section 11 of the Act.
At the outset, we will ask you one question. As rightly pointed out earlier, even though the rent was not given, that you got the, he got the donation of 5 lakhs and 3 lakhs consequently from that. Does it not offset the income? Therefore, how do you say it is wrong at that point of time?
Indeed, your lordship, but Section 13 is regarding any benefit and it does not contemplate a material benefit. As the courts have held, even in cases where there's a reimbursement of all the money, and the that is in the case of Kanhaiya Lal Punch Charitable Trust, where there was a reimbursement of all the profits, the courts have still held that there's a violation of Section 13. Because Section 13 is not regarding whether there was a material benefit or not. It just states that there was a benefit for one of the interested persons.
So, are we to see, I think the question his lordships are putting forth is as a very good angle to it. Please understand. See, in the absence of any material to say what is the rent, so how do we assume that this 8 lakhs is disproportionate? Suppose the rent is equivalent to 8 lakhs, is a different story. Suppose the rent is very nominal, and there is always a factor called the de minimis factor. The insignificant should be ignored. So in the totality of the various activities that has been done in that year, this rental income should be de minimis. So we will ignore that and extend the exemption. What is your problem? How do you say it's wrong?
Indeed, your lordship, but the tax statutes do not follow the provision of, do not follow the principle of de minimis. This is again seen in the case of Agappa Child Center versus Commissioner of Income Tax, the court has held that even when there was a when there was a usage of a refrigerator, even then there would be a violation of Section 13. Because even if it's a small benefit.
We agree with you. The second stage is either one is de minimis, so ignore. Second is we will not ignore. We will allocate and clip that portion of the budget as disallowance. And give the benefit of the trust for rest of the 4 issues. What is your problem? Why do you deny it across on all the 5 issues? In this issue, you deny it. We agree with you on issue 1, assuming. How can this eclipse the benefit which otherwise can be conferred on rest of the 4 issues?
Indeed, your lordship. Your lordship, the Honorable Supreme Court in the case of Commissioner of Customs Import versus Dilip Kumar and Company has held that there must be a strict interpretation of taxation statutes whenever there's an ambiguity, and it must be in favor of the revenue. In the case of Section 13, the heading clearly states that nothing contained in Section 11 and 12 shall operate if the succeeding clauses are violated. So strict interpretation of this clause would mean that nothing, there should be no exemption under Section 11.
Charitable benefit is not just an exemption is a colloquial term. It is basically a concept. It's a philosophy. So when somebody is into charitable, and when you don't accuse of any malafide, any diversion, any misuse, a minimal mistake should be either condoned or clipped to that extent. Why do you extend it for the whole? 13 doesn't, does 13 help you to say, if you find one mistake, however minimal it is, you should now kill the trust on its own. Why? Is it not exorbitant? Is it not an overreach?
Indeed, Your Lordship, but if you follow the term verbatim of Section 13, it states that nothing contained in Section 11 and 12 shall be used, operate. And even in previous cases, in the case of the refrigerator, the entire exemption was denied by the court.
Yes, proceed.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, moving to the first part of my argument that the appellant was in clear violation of Section 13. Your Lordship, the appellant's action in allowing the usage of the trust property without charging any rent by SK and RK Trust would be a clear violation of Section 13 of the Act. Your Lordship, Section 13 essentially stipulates certain circumstances where the exemption granted to charitable trusts under Section 11 would not be applicable. And one such circumstance is when any part of such income or any property of the trust or the institution is directly or indirectly benefiting one of the interested persons. It is the contention of the respondents that the appellant is in violation of Section 13, as firstly, SK and RK Trust would constitute an interested person, and secondly, that a direct benefit has accrued onto them. Moving to the first part of this argument, Your Lordship, subsection 3 of Section 13 provides a list of entities who would be considered as interested persons.
They are interested persons. We concede to the fact they are interested persons. Let's not dispute. Whether you should confine it only to that issue as a disallowance, or you should simply disallow the benefit of the charitable trust. That's the only point you need to address.
Yes, Your Lordship, answering that, Your Lordship, it is a well-settled principle that the eligibility rule of an exemption clause must be given a strict interpretation. This has been, as previously stated, held by the court in the Commissioner of Customs Import Mumbai versus Dilip Kumar and Company, where it was held that the legal principle is that firstly, it must be interpreted strictly, and secondly, it must be interpreted in favor of the revenue. Furthermore, since Section 13 clearly states that nothing contained in Section 11 and 12 shall operate, and a strict interpretation of this would mean that that the entire exemption under Section 11 would be denied if Section 13 is triggered. The entire denial under Section 11 is warranted. Your Lordship, in the present case, violation of any condition under Section 13 of the Act shall therefore lead to the denial of exemption in toto, as it will fall within the ambit of cases where Section 11 shall not apply or operate. And as has been established, there is a clear violation of Section 13. Against such violation, it is submitted that the Honorable ITAT was correct in strictly interpreting the exemption statute of Section 11 to deny the exemption of the entire income of the appellant trust. If Your Lordship is satisfied with the first issue, the Council seeks permission to proceed to the second issue.
Our satisfaction will come later. Now is the time to continue.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, it is the revenue's contention that the Honorable ITAT was correct in holding that the expenditure of rupees 30 lakhs in providing relief to people devastated by flood would amount to a violation of the terms of the trust. And on that ground, the ITAT has rightly denied the exemption. This is because Section 11(1)(a) only exempts income spent towards the objects of the charitable trust, and the acts of the appellant do not fall within the objects of the trust. Furthermore, Your Lordship, Section 12A does not override Section 11(1)(a). Your Lordship,
two questions.
Yes, Your
Lordship. One, the 30 lakhs is indeed satisfying the definition of charitable institution, because what has money, 30 lakhs has been spent for one of the seven causes. Are you doubting that?
No, Your Lordship, it falls within the ambit of Section
12. Correct. And two, as found in that statement of fact, the settlor is the sole trustee. So he's having a dual hat, both as a settlor and as a trustee. So if he confirms a spend, it is only a matter of ratification. All right. So if something falls within the seven objectives, after all, this is a very 30 lakhs is not a small sum and has been spent for a very noble cause. So why should you apply strict interpretation? And especially in a fact pattern where he is a sole trustee and also the settlor, is it possible to read this trust as a larger objective? Because it can be now, as a principle, conceived, even though objectives are not so well defined, if it falls within the objective, statutory objective of section 2 within bracket 15, can we permit it or not? It's a legal question.
Your Lordship, mainly because
there, before you answer that, I'll just add there, just to what Mr. Venkatraman was saying. So you read 2 clause 15 and maybe the trust deed because of the moot proposition, which says that this trust is only for educational purposes. But 2 clause 15 takes into its ambit all the categories of charity. It is a fact that this is a one-off situation whenever there is a disaster, number one. And number two is they have not gone outside the school premises and actually given food or whatever relief material outside.
As you said,
the community kitchen was actually created on the school ground so that the people who were displaced or who required this relief had to come there. So is it not directly connected to the school campus, which is the educational purpose? During that flood, I mean, these are all unforeseen situations, but they used the school campus to put up this community canteen. So putting up the community canteen and feeding. You cannot treat the feeding alone separately, but need to see the location. I'm just putting an argument to you because it has been used in that form. Why can't you allow it as on the facts of this is whatever. I'm not saying it's a purely education trust and this being not a non-education, it should be directly disallowed. In the facts of this situation, why can't it be treated for the benefit of that particular object?
Adding to that, his own question, man. There's even if you say the section 215, it includes charitable purpose, includes relief of the poor, education. First, it starts with relief of the poor, next education, and it ends as advancement of any other object of general public utility. When these three things are there in the very definition section, and it has happened in the premises of the school, how can you deny? Then no philanthropist will come to help anyone. Say, we are now right now in Madras, when we into such a difficulty in water, then nobody will come to help. Is it your intention that nothing but should be given to anyone? They ask the fact they intend to give for the rightful purpose.
Apologies, Your Lordship, I think
just to add in a very light way, on a misnomer, during flood time, sometimes department says any amount given to these flood relief funds is allowable deduction. But actually for the flood relief now, through the trust where we have money, you disallow. Doesn't it contradict? I mean, I'm putting a very hard argument on you just to consider this.
Officer, please give her 2 more minutes because we have taken this
time. Yeah. Yeah.
2 more minutes.
Apologies, Your Lordship. I didn't really catch the question posed by Justice B. Rajendra because my net went in the middle. So I did not hear the first part of your question.
First part of the question is,
yes.
Section 215 starts with a word. Charitable purposes includes relief of the poor. The starting of the section is relief of the poor. Next only comes to education. And it ends advancement of any other object of general public utility. If this is the crux of the very definition under your act, you are now saying a person who comes to the rescue of poor people, especially in the time of a flood, and that too in his premises, where education is taken, how do you deny that? Given that definitely 2 minutes time is given. Yes.
Yes, Your Lordship, coming to the first part of the question, the phrase such purposes has been interpreted by the Delhi High Court to mean that only the purposes for which the charitable trust has been initially established, that is the objects of the trust. This has been laid down by the Delhi High Court in the case of Mool Chand Charity Ram Trust case. And hence the exemption can only be denied when the income is spent towards the objects of the trust. Your Lordship, moving to the second part of the question, that whether the settlor being the sole trustee has the power to change the actions. Your Lordship, when after a trust is validly created, the settlor and the sole trustee, the settlor and the trustee work in different capacities. So the settlor does not have the power to add or revoke to the initial objects after the trust has been validly declared and the declaration is done. For any amendment, there needs to be due procedure followed. And hence, just the mere action of the settlor in spending a certain amount of money would not constitute an amendment to the trust.
It is an emergency. It is an emergency. Flood is an emergency. At that point of time, can you want to go back to all the procedures to do this? Would it not be possible? Is it not acceptable? For an emergency, such a contingency can be done.
Indeed, Your Lordship, but Your Lordship, an emergency is not contemplated under the Income Tax Act. The Income Tax Act states that only such situations, only objects.
Good answer. Carry on.
Make a good standing.
Yes, Your Lordship. So the Income Tax Act only states that the income will be exempted if it's if the income has been spent towards the objects of which, for which the trust was initially established. Yes, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, if I could start from the beginning of my argument.
Okay.
Your Lordship, Section 11(1)(a) exempts income derived from property held under trust only for charitable or religious purposes to the extent to which such income is applied to such charitable or religious purposes for which the trust itself has been established. The term such purposes refers to the purposes for which the trust has been established, as has been stated by the courts in numerous cases.
And we now say such purposes in emergency, if it meets with the purposes and objectives enshrined in 250, then the trust will also meet with the objective. Such purposes, are we capable of interpreting it? Times of emergency, if it falls within the 7, it can still be extended or not. We just want your help. You forget the case. Suppose, can we now use, interpret the expression such purposes in an emergency situation? What is your advice?
Indeed, Your Lordship, there could be a possibility, but the precedents say that such purposes must only be applied to the objects of the trust, which has been led by the Delhi High Court and the Gujarat High Court.
Then there is another provision, 11(1)(a) in exemption. The 15% of the income is unfettered. That can we not take into consideration? That this 30 lakhs or whatever the amount could not be utilized as the 15% unfettered right. For every trust, they need to spend 85%, but the 15% can be done free at the instance of them or kept there. Would it not be possible to accommodate this within the 15% category?
Your Lordship, just give me a minute.
I'll just help you, don't worry. That 15% is more for accumulation.
Accumulation.
Yeah, that's for the fifth issue. In fact, Lordship is hinting an answer there. He's now aiding you to answer that question also.
All right.
Much obliged, Your Lordships. Your Lordship, therefore, the appellant will only be entitled to exemption under Section 11(1)(a) if the income was spent towards the objectives of the trust, that is education. Your Lordship, it is our contention that the acts of the appellant do not fall within the objects of the trust because the act, and I shall prove this in a twofold manner. Firstly, the acts of the trustees are ultra-virus to the objects of the trust. And secondly, the objects of the trust have not been amended. Moving to the first limb of my argument, Your Lordship, activities which are not specifically mentioned in the objects of the trust would only be considered to be intra-virus if they are reasonably incidental to the objects of the trust. In this case, the construction of a community canteen cannot be held to be reasonably
incidental. Yeah. Why not it be incidental? Because it is within the school, as Mr. Arvind Pandey was saying. It is within the school campus.
Your Lordship, yes, but this 30 lakhs that were spent towards the construction of a canteen cannot be said to be incidental to education.
It was not the 30 lakhs were spent for the canteen alone. Yes. It was for the inclusion of the supply given. Therefore, you can't term this as a total capital expenditure for the canteen.
I'll just add one more question along the judge, so you'll be able to appreciate. Have you placed any case law or any kind of argument in your memorial that when you kind of spend like this for a natural calamity or an unforeseen event, which goes beyond the scope of the object of the trust, then that would not amount to an expenditure for the purpose of the trust? Have you placed any case law, or has Gujarat or the Patna judgment or the Madras judgment, which you are mentioning, which is not part of the trust deed, has to be disallowed? Do they deal with natural calamities like this or unforeseen situations?
Your Lordship, no, they do not deal with unforeseen situations.
Very fair.
Carry on. Yeah, please proceed. Your Lordship, therefore, the acts of the appellee would not be intravirus to the objects of the trust, as it cannot be considered to be reasonably incidental. Proceeding to the second limb of my argument, there has been no amendment in terms of the trust by the settlor. Your Lordship, when the settlor and the trustee are the same person, his capacity as a settlor and his capacity as a trustee are different. And after the declaration of the trust, he only holds property as a trustee. And if the trust has been validly created, the subsequent acts of the founder would not affect the initial declaration of the trust. Hence, when a charity has been founded and trusts have been declared, the founder has no power later on to revoke, vary, or add to the trust without following due procedure.
Have you examined any clause which is slightly omnibus? Will there be always trust will have residuary clauses? Have you examined that and denied that there is no residuary? I don't see a finding at all anywhere. So suppose there is a residuary clause, will you still be you will be happy enough to extend it? Had there been a residuary clause? It's academic, but still we are asking a question.
Your Lordship, had there been a residuary clause and the settlor had followed due procedure, then yes, we would accept it.
Well, that no, there was... it is in the original trust itself, there is the residuary clause. Will you allow it or not? You can answer, you can help the court. Don't worry about, we are not deciding win or lose. We are deciding who is best, that's all. Please understand that. Go ahead.
Your Lordship, if there was such a clause, then we would have accepted it.
Very fair, very fair. Good.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Lordship, proceeding to the third limb of my argument, proceeding, the Section 12A stipulates the conditions for registration of a trust. The provisions of Section 12A, which deal with registration, do not in any manner dilute the mandatory requirements of Section 11. Section 12A is merely a condition precedent for availing the benefit under Section 11 and 12. The various high courts in numerous cases have held that whether the application of funds by the appellant can claim benefit of exemption under Section 11 and 12 are questions which the assessing officer has to answer and are not required to be analyzed by the commissioner while considering application for grant of registration under Section 12A. The appellant has to comply with provisions of Section 11(1)(a) to claim the benefit of exemption under the provision. And the fact that the appellant has been granted registration under Section 12A does not ipso facto entitle him to automatically gain the exemption. In the present case, the registration has been granted to the appellant under Section 12A in the year 1980. In 2015, the appellant has violated the objectives of the trust by assisting people affected by floods. And hence, registration granted in 1980 would not ipso facto entitle the appellant to exemption under Section 11 in the assessment year 2016 to 2017. And since the appellants have not complied with the provisions of Section 11...
So you are restricting, good point. So you are restricting the disallowance only for 1 year. You are allowing the trust to otherwise function.
Your Lordship, the exemption has been denied for this particular year.
They are not, they have not cancelled the registry. Yes. Go ahead.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the appellant would only be granted exemption if they have complied with the provisions of Section 11(1)(a), which in this case they have not. Based on the grounds established, it is our submission that the Honorable IDAT was correct in holding that the expenditure of rupees 30 lakhs towards providing relief to people affected by floods would amount to a violation of the terms of the trust and consequently denying the exemption claimed by the appellant under Section 11(1). If Your Lordship is pleased, I seek permission to call my co-counsel. Much obliged, Your Lordship.
Greetings to the bench. At the outset, I would like to know if I'm audible and visible.
Yes, proceed.
Much obliged, Your Lordship. The council seeks permission to collectively address the benches, Your Lordship, once again. If that's fine.
Yes.
Thank you, Your Lordship. With your kind permission, I would like to move on to issue 3 at hand. Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, issue 3 in the present case essentially deals with whether the donation made by Reliance Industries Limited constitutes to a corpus donation, and as such, is excluded from the total income of the trust. Section 11(1)(d) of the Act essentially states that any donation that has been made under a specific direction to contribute to the corpus of the trust would constitute a corpus donation, and as such, will gain the exemption. The fact that the donation made by Reliance Industries does not constitute a corpus donation will be shown by a twofold argument, Your Lordship. Firstly, that the donation was not accompanied with a specific direction as such. And secondly, that whilst determining the nature of a donation itself, what is more important or is pertinent is the intent of the donor as against the manner in which it was utilized. Your Lordship, coming down to the first limb of my argument, Your Lordship, Section 11(1)(d), as previously stated, mandates the requirement of a specific direction to be accompanied by the donor for a donation made thereof to contribute to the corpus of the trust.
The question here is,
Your Lordship,
when Reliance gave 75 lakhs, it not only gave money to you, it also delegated its discretion to you. It is, you have to understand it as twofold. One is transfer of 75 lakhs. Another is the way in which you want to use, I will not object. So whatever you do, it has my consent. So instead of donor exercising it at his level and then sending it, donor is consenting with the decision-making process of the donee to say, whatever your decision you take, I'm not going to question it. Therefore, there is a tacit approval given to the donee. You can use it in whatever way. The donee chooses to create a corpus which has the tacit consent of the donor. What is wrong?
Lordship,
why not give the benefit?
Lordship, the very fact that there is no specific direction, but a direction has to use it in whatever.
Does the law say specific?
Mr. Lordship, the verbatim of section 11.1d itself says specific direction. And even if we go under the Black Law's dictionary to understand what specific direction means, it specific, the word specific itself means, it means a restricted or a very particular direction.
See, we'll put the reverse of it. No, let's test it. It's a good point. See, there's a specific direction. Now, I tell you, you do it in whatever you, what, how do you say that it is not a specific direction, number one? The fact that an option is exercised by the donee, not objected to, then it gets validated. So, is it not meeting with the spirit of the section that there is a specific direction because there is a concurrence, whether it flows from the donor directly or a decision taken by the donee is validated by the donor without any objection, will it not meet the standard of specific direction?
No, Your Lordship, it clearly does not, because I will substantiate this furthermore with the case law itself as given by the Rajasthan High Court. This was a case where the UP government gave certain amount to a trust in form of a check, stating that only the manner in which it is utilized has to be reported back to the government. It did not state that it has to be used in this particular manner or whatsoever.
That's the point. See, good point. See, there it says how you use it, you report to me. It doesn't authorize you to take a call. Here, Reliance is saying, I authorize you to take a call and I'm with you. You can't diverse Reliance participation or approval from this case, unlike the other case.
Your Lordship, but it's also important to note that in both the cases, the donation was made to the object of the trust itself in a vague manner, saying that Your Lordship, though the UP government said that you report back to me in a manner in which you utilize it, it did not state that you have to utilize it in this manner, nor did it bar specifically that it should not be used as a corpus, similar
but
to this case.
It did not give the permission. Suppose it has given the permission, you take a decision and you also inform the utilization. It's a different question. Here, there is the delegation of taking a decision and giving a concurrence doesn't appear to be there in that case, from whatever little we can understand. Because here, that's a specific delegation. I agree with whatever you take. You have the option. See, as Reliance has the option to either spend it in the year or as a corpus, it gives that option and say, your decision will be also my decision. There is a participation. How do you say that it is not?
Your Lordship, this can even if you don't agree with the decision that was given in the UP government's case, that's the Rajasthan case, even the Karnataka government has held a similar factor itself. Sorry, Your Lordship, that's a different case. My bad. I'm sorry for going into that. Your Lordship, even if the UP government case itself is taken into consideration, even there, they have not barred the manner in which it is utilized at all. They have said you use it in whatever manner you want to, but just report back to us. Here, though they have not asked for the particular trust to report back to them, it does not bar them to use it in whatever manner either. And in both the cases, the consequences of the directions are the same. That is, you use it in whatever manner you want, just report back to us in one case. In the other case, you don't report it back to us. So in both cases, there is a lack of a specific direction, Your Lordship. And as required by the verbatim itself, a specific direction means a direction which essentially tells the trust to use it for their corpus itself.
So we have to hold that it can never be delegated.
Yes, Your Lordship, essentially.
Okay.
Your Lordship, so much, and I would like to move on with my thank you so much, Your Lordship. Yes, Your Lordship. So in the absence of such an explicit direction, the facts and circumstances of the case can also be considered as argued by the appellant itself. But such facts and circumstances must also clearly show that there was an intention by the donor that it should be used for the corpus of the trust. Only when such an intention can clearly be highlighted, which is not the particular case because the discretion has been given away, the donation cannot be constituted as corpus donation at all, Your Lordship. Due to this lack of this specific direction itself, the benefit that's given under Section 11.1d is not attracted at all. Now, moving on to the second limb of my argument, Your Lordship, that the verbatim of the provision itself clearly states that what is taken into consideration is the intent of the donor. In the absence of such a specific direction, even if the recipient goes ahead and utilizes it.
That's where we are having a doubt. You are right. You have pitched it correctly. It is the intention of the donor that matters. The donor says, whatever the donee takes, I endorse it.
Your Lordship, in that case, it can still
be... Are you saying the law does not permit the choice with the donee? The choice has to be exercised only by the donor in exclusion of the donee. That's the law you want us to declare.
Oh, Your Lordship, I'm just stating that if the donor still has the discretion to give the amount to whatever matter that they deem fit. For example, if it is to be used for the construction of a school itself, they can give it. There is nothing stopping them from doing it. If in the lack of a specific direction, the donation is not exempted from income tax altogether, Your Lordship. It's still considered as income under Section 12 and is still given the exemption that is required. But for the process, for the purpose of Section 11.1d, what is required is a specific direction on the part of the donor. The intention of the donor is what is the most important aspect in this particular provision, Your Lordship. And that's what differentiates it from Section 11.2 altogether. And in the lack of such a specific direction.
1 minute, his Lordship wants to raise a question.
Oh, I'm so sorry, Your Lordship. Let us assume
that any donor, after seeing the object, convinced about the object, and knowing fully well that trust is doing a good work, he has voluntarily come and give a money without specifying a particular thing on the presumption that this amount will be utilized for the purpose of further upgrading of the object of the trust. That is why he might not have given the correct direction, but he was very much assured that this will be treated as a corpus, so the funds could be utilized. Can we not take a stand?
Yes, like, Your Lordship, shortly. If we can clearly be
that
strong.
Particular company, knowing very well about this particular trust, having their past performance, has come to a conclusion, yes, I'm donating. I'm very confident that he will do it. That is why they did not specify. What is your answer for that?
Your Lordship, that will be an assumption in the present case, given that no such stipulation has even been made to that extent.
Because you admit, in the past so many years, there has never been any denial or rejection of their claims. In all their assessments, the assessments were passed through. Therefore, the consistent performance has been proved, even accepted by you in the previous assessments.
Yes, Your Lordship, even if that was the case, in what we will be presently assuming is that Reliance had absolute knowledge about everything about the trust in entirety. And such an assumption cannot be made based on the facts that have been stipulated at all.
Well, if they had full knowledge, like what you're saying, about the entire facts, then why didn't Reliance object to it being treated as a corpus? And did they thereafter give a specific direction, don't use it as a corpus? I mean, we're all actually hypothetically considering. The point is, Reliance has not specifically written how to use, but they have not specifically written how not to use also. So the word specific direction should be, I mean, if I go by the appellant's case also, they say that the Reliance had the full knowledge of how the actual funds were used later, which amounts to acknowledging the fact and not opposing as a specific direction. In the memorial, para 39 and 40, they rely on the Bombay judgment, which talks about how at least there must be a subsequent conduct of confirmation. So though it's a slightly far-fetched argument which they're making, but for you also to argue, you as a department, did you seek from Reliance that please give me a letter where they have accepted in that manner and whatever manner? You also not taken. So will that disentitle the appellant from taking the benefit of it? Sorry, I'm just intervening. I thought you can answer this.
No. Yeah.
Give him also the 2 minutes extra.
Thank you so much. Just take
a consuming question.
Yeah, it's a very interesting.
Thank you, Lordship, firstly, for the extension of time. Coming down to the answer, an assumption, an interpretation of this sort would essentially mean that a lack of a specific direction is also a specific direction. That would be against the verbatim of the statute itself, Your Lordship. I feel, at least based on that rationale, a specific direction would be required in this present case, failing which the donation would not amount to a corpus donation at all.
So in your view, how should a specific direction be when the section does not contemplate how?
Oh, your lordship, stating that it is supposed to be used for an endowment fund, or that it is supposed to be used to add on to a capital or for purchasing of furniture, because furniture is generally used as adds up to the capital of the trust itself, or for the purchase of a land or a building or so on and so forth. In such a case, it would constitute a corpus donation, on lordship. In the lack of such a direction, it cannot. And that's what the provision essentially states, your lordship, as far as my knowledge extends.
So the second part of the argument, should it be in writing or not?
Your lordship, no, it can be implied as well. It doesn't have to be explicit altogether.
That is where we are coming. By the subsequent conduct, by impliedly, they have made it to understand it should be treated as a corpus bond. Why don't the department accept that? That is their argument. Feel free.
Yes. Your lordship, can you please repeat the question? I kind of forgot it in all this.
No. That is why when you use the word, we didn't use the word imply. All three of us wantonly did not use the word imply earlier, because by the subsequent conduct, they have made it to understand, they have acknowledged. That means they impliedly, they have agreed it should be only a corpus fund. That argument, why don't the department accept it if it is reasonable, correct, acceptable, when they are taking into consideration the previous conduct of the parties?
Your lordship, but while accounting for the previous conduct of the trust itself, it cannot be said that the trust has used every donation that is acquired for as a part of its corpus at all. Because coming down to the next issue itself, which I'll be arguing very soon, it has even conducted an event in Singapore. So when it comes to the conduct of the trust, it has used this income for various different reasons. So highlighting that the intent is for the corpus, even though it can be... I'm not very sure about this, your lordship. I humbly apologize for the same. Even though it may be confirmed through subsequent conduct, that is not the present case. That cannot be argued, because that would be an assumption, your lordship.
All right. You continue in your stay.
Thank you so much, your lordship. Your lordship, if the arguments made under this...
Go to Singapore.
Yes, your lordship. Your lordship, issue 4 essentially deals with whether...
They have brought 75 lakhs into India. Yeah. What's your problem in giving? Why are you denying? They brought money to India. What's your problem?
They are spending it only in India. There are 75 lakhs which they have brought. 75 lakhs they spend there. They brought 75 lakhs here for spending. What is it, use?
Your lordship, as the bench itself previously observed, in this present case, there is a case where I've brought in 75 lakhs after spending 75 lakhs. But again, reading into this provision saying that you can apply it abroad will also set it up as a precedent. So in a case where 75 lakhs is spent abroad, but only 15 lakhs is brought back, then it becomes problematic, your lordship. It is based on that I raise an issue in this present argument. Your lordship, the issue 4 as stated.
So are we saying, when it comes to foreign funds, you can only receive it through an FCNR account. You cannot apply it. Is there a geographical limitation? Where is the limitation?
Oh, your lordship.
You have to apply. The trust has to apply. That's what it says. But where does it put the spokes? That the application has to be fully in India or exclusively in India. Where do we get it?
Lordship, so this is the part of the second part of my argument. So I'll be getting down to that right now. Lordship, if the provision under section 11(1)(a) is read, it essentially states that to the extent which such income is applied to such purposes in India, as what has been presently claimed, what is important is such purposes in India, because in India comes after very right next to such purposes. But it's also important to note that there is no comma there, which would again show that such in India is only limited to such purposes. So a joint reading of the entire section would show that not only the expenditure, the situs of the expenditure, but also the situs of the object, both must be in India. This is the exact interpretation that has been taken by the Delhi High Court in DIT versus NASSCOM, your lordship. The court further went on and held that a literal interpretation has to be taken of this particular statute, because a liberal interpretation is not required, because once you take a literal interpretation, there is no absurdity that arises due to the absence of any absurdity. Yes, your lordship.
Yeah, see, we are worried about one aspect. application in terms of the trust is as long as the end use, which is what his lordship was asking 3 minutes ago, if the end use is ultimately in India,
you are frozen, Mr. Venkat.
Oh, lordship, may I drink water by then?
Yeah, please take care.
Thanks so much.
Judges, can we wait for 2 minutes for sir to join again?
Sure.
Yeah, by the time he joins, I can just put a question to the
Jesse Lodger.
Yes, as long as the intention is to gather, repeat, Mr. Venkatraman. You have to repeat fully. You have frozen.
You are muted. Please repeat.
I'm audible now?
Yes,
sir, you're audible now.
So, if the intention is ultimately to use it in India, and when you can receive a donation from outside India, why not you conduct an event outside India to receive a donation? How is it barred? Where is the geographical limitation?
Your Lordship, this essentially goes under the idea that the legislature does not intend to forgo the revenue as well as the benefits that is accrued from allowing a particular exemption. That is in a case where...
So are you agreeing to the fact the revenue can come from abroad if you have an FCNR pool?
Yes, Your Lordship.
Right. If you can that, what is the problem in investing to generate the revenue?
Your Lordship, there's absolutely no issue with that. But for with respect to Section 11(1)(a), what is required is that the application should be done within India and the object must also be in India. So though it can be satisfied.
The application is ultimately to benefit the cause in India. If you read that, is CITES an issue? See, if you come to Section 9, CITES is an issue. It specifies CITES.
Oh, Your Lordship, I
think sir is again. We'll connect to sir and get back.
Oh, Your Lordships, P.S. Arvind Pandyan, sir, you had a question.
No. I think it's almost the same what Mr. Venkatraman was asking. So I don't want to.
Are you aware of the judgment? Brand Equity Foundation case, where is AZT?
Oh, Your Lordship, I'm not entirely sure. If you could tell me.
Taxman Comp 323.
Oh, Your Lordship, can I look it up if it's okay with?
It's okay, no problem. And the appellants, are you at least aware about that judgment? The judgment is Brand Equity Foundation versus ACTE, 23 Taxmen, 323 Delhi case. Neither party is aware. Sorry. The answer lies in that question.
Again, frozen, you must.
Sir, now you can.
Yes, sir. Are you facing any issues, sir?
Sir, you are.
So is everything good at your end?
Yeah, am I audible, visible?
No, we are audible. Can we
resume, sir? Thank you.
Your Lordship, you had a question.
Give me 1 minute extra because of the audience. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Your Lordship, you had a question previously.
No, same. See, if is there, where does it refer to CITES? Section 9 refers, but Section 11 doesn't refer to CITES. So why do you read CITES into 11?
Because Your Lordships, it has been continuously held that what section requires is both that the applied, the word applied has itself been understood in a manner. Yes, Your Lordship. Okay. Lordship, basically the word applied in Section 11 has been interpreted in such a manner that both the expenditure as well as the object on which it is applied is taken into consideration.
Go to the last issue. You may run out of time. Go to the last issue.
Your Lordship, can I skip this issue then? Completely. Right, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the last issue or the fifth issue at the hand deals with whether the income accumulated by the trust is applied.
He has 2 points to address those 2 points. He says it's a vested right. And he says there is a stay. Those periods should be excluded. If you exclude it, they have completed the whole building work in February 2016 as per the facts. So how do you now say it is restricted to 5 years?
Oh, Your Lordship.
Also, one more thing. He says the relevant period at which they started, at that point, it was 10 years. The amendment came in only in 2015. And the relevant period when it started was 2016. So that is also an added point for you.
And vested rights can be extinguished only retrospectively through a legislation. You can't do it through an interpretation. That's a certain
issue. Surely, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, if if the Financial Act, the Financial Amendment Act of 2015 is looked at under application of the amendment, it says, it particularly says this amendment will take effect from 2016 and it will be applicable on the assessable years from 2016 and 17. The present case that we're dealing with, the assessment year is in 2016 and 17. Though it says that it would be subsequently from these years, it would essentially mean that whatever assessment years would fall after that particular year, in all those years, the amount will have to be expended within the year term of 5 years itself, Your Lordship.
He therefore says it is prospective, and therefore the question is a vested right acquired in 2009-10. I will take, you have not...
Sir, again.
Sir is against stuff. I hope we can just wait for sir to get back. And the time is paused. You don't have to worry. We are checking with sir and we'll get back immediately.
Sir, you have been paused for a moment.
So you can continue. I think that's a problem. I'm dropping. You carry on.
Delhi is freezing.
Can we continue, sir?
Yes.
Please. You. Oh, Your Lordship.
Carry on, speaker.
Your Lordship, you had a question.
Go ahead.
No, that's
Your Lordship, Section 11-2 essentially states that the income can only be accumulated for a period of 5 years. And especially after the 2015 Amendment Act, which says that from the assessment years of 2016 and 17, income can only be accumulated for a period of 5 years. In the present case, and the only exception to this particular rule is if there is an order of the court. In the present case, under the clarification that was issued to us, it was very clearly stipulated there was no order or injunction of the court with respect to the land at all. There was only a litigation. A mere litigation itself would not attract the...
Quite right. So second point gets excluded. Very good.
Altogether, Your Honor. So based on the interpretation of the applicability of the 2015 amendment itself, from the assessment years of 2016 and 17, which is the present case, there can only be an accumulation of up to 5 years, Your Lordship. In the present case, there has been a very clear violation of this rule or this law, based on which I plead before this present High Court that the exemption there under should be essentially denied. Your Lordship, if you're satisfied with the issues raised, I would like to move on to the prayer at hand.
As we have said, our satisfaction will come in the last. So you carry on. To your satisfaction, you can do it.
Your Lordship, Priya.
Dismiss the appeal with cost.
Yes, we'll go in for the reply.
Sorry, Your Lordship.
Yes, appellant side, you have the right to reply.
Your Lordship, lastly, it was a huge honor to plead before this honorable bench. It's not a misunderstanding.
All of you did a wonderful job.
Our pleasure to hear you all. Good.
Thank you so much, Your Lordship.
Greetings, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the council seeks permission to proceed with the rebuttals.
Yes.
Your Lordship, firstly, the council is on behalf of the respondent while stating that the reason that they denied the entire exemption stated that nothing contained in Section 11 or 12 shall operate, these are the words that are written in Section 13, this was their submission. But Your Lordship, subsection 1 of Section 13, the entire line states that nothing contained in Section 11 or 12 shall operate so as to exclude from the total income, Your Lordship, which has not been conveniently stated by the respondent in the present case. Secondly, Your Lordship, they have stated that Section 11, subsection 1, clause A, grants exemption on objects. But as stated by the council in the present case, Your Lordship, through the citation of cases such as Nadigar Sangam Charitable Trust, either Your Lordship's first of all, the construction of, as stated in the arguments as well, the ultimate application of 30 lakhs was towards the object of the trust and was to be considered within the scope, or if it was not, it was to be considered as an allied charitable activity, Your Lordship. Thirdly, Your Lordship, they have emphasized on a specific direction being present at, but Your Lordship, as cited through the case of Director of Income Tax versus Ramakrishna Seva Ashram, the specific direction does not. There is not enough importance to be attached to the specific direction if the intention of the donor is visible through the facts of the case. Fourthly, Your Lordship, my co-counsel has already explained the difference between spent and applied, and that is why, Your Lordship, the contention made by the respondent side that the amount was to be considered as applied outside India does not hold good. And lastly, Your Lordship, the council would like to, as stated, that the council had the right to accumulate for maximum period of 10 years as the law which was applicable in 2008 and 9 should be applied and not the law. That is the law under which the amount was actually accumulated and not the change.
No, when it comes to application, he had a point. He said, there is no comma. Therefore, both object and application has to be within India. So indirectly, CITES is referred in section 11. That is their case. So what is your answer for that?
Your Lordship, as my co-counsel already highlighted the judgment, which stated that there's a difference between spending and application. If the expenditure is outside India, the application can still be contended to be within India. If the application
the expression application is an application associated with charitable institution. When you apply, it includes spending also. So you can't say I will apply, but it will be spent outside India. That dissection doesn't appear to be available in law. That is one question. Now, the second question which he raised was this specific direction. See, he made a point. You have to grip at it. He said specific direction means the authority is vested only with the donor. If you now say specific direction will be deemed to be also specific direction in the absence of a specific direction, then why do you put that word? He says you are frustrating, your interpretation is frustrating the provision of law in the act. When it says specific direction, the term specific gives that authority only to the donor, which he cannot delegate. So what's your answer for that?
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, in the present case, the subsequent confirmation as stated by the appellants was given by the donor. The donee has not acted the amount which
was... How do you say he has given? So how do you draw the confirmation? It's only an inference. But the law mandates a confirmation. There's a difference between inference and confirmation. We can draw an inference because he has not objected. But the law requires a confirmation. That's what he's saying. So what is your answer to that?
Much obliged, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, as stated by the appellant earlier as well, that the intention of the donor is to be seen. Because, Your Lordship, the fact in the present case, as the creation of the endowment fund, Your Lordship, was as stated, the creation of endowment fund in the name of Reliance Industries Limited goes to show that such an endowment fund could not have been created if Reliance did not already agree that the amount would have been treated and is given for the treatment as corpus of the trust in the present case. And that is why, Your Lordship, that in the present case, even though that's direction...
One minute, His Lordship wants to raise it.
Did you make them aware that you created in their name? Because as rightly earlier he pointed out, you could have created in your own name, or you could have created in another name. But you made it in that donor's name. But at least, by some balance of right, have you mentioned it? Have you made it known to him? Have you written like that?
Your Lordship, the creation of endowment fund cannot be done without the person in whose name the endowment fund is to be created. That is why the councils are presenting this argument. Further, Your Lordship, to answer another question that Your Lordship stated, the difference between spent and applied. Your Lordship, the councils on behalf of the appellant, my co-counsel already cited the cases of Thanthi Trust versus Commissioner of Income Tax, as well as Nizam's Charitable Trust case, in which a difference was explained between the meaning of the word spent and the meaning of the word applied in section 11 subsection 1. And Your Lordship, to the last issue, that the as stated by the respondents, that the amount was accumulated, that the provision of section 2015-16 will apply. Your Lordship, it is humbly contended that the as stated that the accumulation was made in 8-9 and not in 15-16. So therefore, the law that was prevalent during 8-9 should be applied, as Your Lordship even stated that it is a vested right and should be applied the law of 2008 and 9 should apply in the present case, Your Lordships.
In an exemption, do you have vested right?
Could you please repeat the question?
It is always a matter of Crown's choice.
Your Lordships, the law at the time of law at the time of accumulation stated that we had a right to accumulate for 10 years. We are not stating that the right exemption regard to exemption.
So vested right applies also to exemption. That's your choice.
Much of my Your Lordship, the vested right does not, we are not stating currently that the vested right.
I'm applies. Saying something in your favor only.
Yes, you didn't catch the point.
Much of my Your Lordship. Your Lordship, the it's been an honor to argue in front of this honorable court. Thank you,
Your Lordship. To listen to all of you also. You have your 5 minutes, then they also have a chance.
Your Lordship, we have reserved.
Normally, the respondent do not have a choice, but then Here we give you 2 minutes, you please.
Thank you so much, Your Lordship. Your Lordship, after listening to the rebuttals that have been made by my learned counsels for the appellant, we have 4 points of responses. Firstly, as we were elaborated in our pleadings, any benefit to be considered in ascertaining a Section 13 violation must be with respect to the interested person, which is SK Trust and RK Trust. The possibility of such rent being exempted.
He has the point there. He says it is only a disallowance from the total income. The expression total income should not be lost sight of. And therefore, restrict the disallowance to issue one and allow the rest. He is virtually conceding an issue one. He only wants the rest of the issues should be intact. What's your answer?
Your Lordship, even so, Section 13 is essentially triggered as soon as there is a violation. And Your Lordship, once Section 13 is triggered, nothing in Section 11, 1 and 12 applies. Therefore, which clearly shows that once you have made a particular violation of what you're supposed to do, there will be an entire total denial. Your Lordship, as you vertically stated before, there's either right or wrong in tax law, Your Lordship. There's no in between. Lordship, going on to the second point of contention, the appellant's contention is that there is a possible confirmation of endowment fund is not well placed. This is because the mere act of naming an endowment fund does not require any confirmation being made by Reliance Limited at all. In the present case, there are no facts as to if the company had subsequently endorsed the endowment fund or even knew that their donation had been used in that particular manner. Thirdly, Your Lordship, the community canteen in no case can be considered an ancillary or allied purpose of charitable object to the trust. No children with special needs or unemployed youth are benefiting in terms of their education. Therefore, it's a clear violation of the objects of the trust itself and does not carry any ancillary nexus with the trust either, Your Lordship.
Why don't we deal it as a humane education, the very service which will enthuse, suppose this idea gets implanted in the hearts and minds of the children who go to school. This whole idea, they see it visibly. It's a practical laboratory experiment. So it will only encourage them. It's also a part of education. Yeah, the needy is served, but it's happening in the campus. So it's also part of education. We'll give it in the main class itself. Why incident?
Your Lordship, I completely agree with what is being said, but the word education has been interpreted in a narrow manner to mean institutional education.
Where?
Your Lordship, can I just refer to my memo for the case, Your Lordship?
Institutional education, that's why Arvind is saying, it's an institutional education happening within the institution, not elsewhere.
No, Your Lordship, for that matter, the Supreme Court has even held that, to state in the words of the Supreme Court itself, every man learns something when they have been pickpocketed, that they have to be safe the next time. But that does not amount to education. What is education for the purposes of the of Section 215 is institutional
pickpocket
education.
Pickpocket won't come. But the converse of pickpocket, which is good, serving the needy, is always education. The negative can't be. You can't see, understand, when you use the analogy, be careful. So pickpocket won't come. You can't compare pickpocket with serving the needy in terms of this educational syllabus. Go ahead.
Thank you, Lordship. And lastly, Your Lordship, application of income refers to the way the income was used to fulfill a charitable object. The fact that there's no SCOM as priorly stipulated clearly shows that the expenditure and the charitable trust must be within the bounds of India. Charitable object must be within the bounds of India. In this case, 75 lakhs being used to fulfill no charitable object, but rather being used to conduct a cultural event in a different country altogether. Therefore, will forfeit exemption altogether, Your Lordship. Those are the sir rebuttals for the respondents.
I think we are ahead of time. So one question to both of you. We'll swap. You argue for 2 minutes because you would have prepared memorials both ways. So yes, you argue sir. Let the first appellant argue 2 minutes against yourself. What would be the point which you feel is against you?
Oh, Your Lordship, can you please repeat that if that's not a problem?
We are putting it first to the other side.
That's right.
Indeed,
you guys prepare memorials both sides. All right. Indeed, so you are given 2 minutes to argue against yourself. Which will be the point which you want to argue against yourself? both sides will get two minutes.
Minutes.
We have to close it up 5:40.
Your Lordship, which issues? If you could state which issues, Your Lordship.
No, you chair. Choice is yours. You argue. You take one issue and argue against.
The five issue, whichever issue you take, but you say which is against you.
Fair. Let's see. This is a test for your fairness. Yeah, go ahead.
Your Lordship, I would choose to argue the second issue from the side of the respondents, which was that application of income of towards construction of community canteen would not be included in the would not be in consonance with the terms of the trust. Your Lordship, firstly, in this present situation, the appellant has constructed a community canteen, but the appellant has not the objects of the appellant clearly state the appellant was constructed for the purpose of education to. And that education was to be provided to children with special needs and your lordship for construction of learning and vocational training centers, which goes to show that subsection 2 clause 15 of which states charitable purpose talk and the current trust is registered as in providing education to the general public. But your lordship, now the council would like to state the case of Commissioner of Income Tax versus Kanika Devasthan Charities, this which was of this honorable court, in where it was held that as long as the activities were within the consonants of the trust, then the exemption would be allowed. But if the activities were not in consonance, the exemption would not be allowed. Further, your lordship, in the case of Moolchand Khetiram Trust versus Commissioner of Income Tax, the Delhi High Court held that if the application of income is outside the scope of its objects, even if its activities are charitable in nature, then the exemption under Section 11 would not be allowed. Further, your lordship, the council would like to now move on to the point that that the appellant has stated regarding notional amendment. Your lordship, section 12 subsection 1 clause AB clearly states that in case a trust which is registered under section 12A before the amendment of 1996, the trust undertakes any modification or alteration of its objects, the same has to be intimated to the Commissioner of Income Tax within period of 30 days. Otherwise, your lordship, as section 12A is a condition for an applicability of section 11, if section 12 is not satisfied, section 11 would not be applied, and that is why your lordship exemption under section 11 would be denied.
Good.
If your lordship's permit.
No. We'll go for the other side. One person
is answered. Another one. Yes. Other side.
Who is going to speak?
Both any one of you.
Oh, your lordships, can we take 1 minute each and summarize one issue?
Very no. Please. When they we have denied them, so you took take a chance.
Oh, okay. Sure. Your lordship, and under issue 3, corpus donation can be both the. Especially based on the ratio that had been laid down in the Ramakrishna Seva Ashrama as well as Sukhdev Chand case, both the intention of the donor must be coupled with the manner in which it is utilized, and they should not be looked in isolation of one another. In the present case, both the intention of the donor and the manner in which it has to be utilized, and that will be the correct manner to interpret section 11 1D altogether. So therefore, your lordship, in the present case, since Reliance has donated an amount of 75 lakhs with absolutely no direction, or on the other hand, with an implied consent to use it in whichever manner that deems fit, and further, since Reliance has deposited the same and has used it as a corpus donation, it must be construed as a corpus donation altogether, your lordship. Now, moving on to issue 4, your lordship, it is true that Section 11.1a takes into consideration both the situs of expenditure as well as the object. Your lordship, under Section 11.1a, what is actually more important for the purpose of Section 11.1a is where the object is situated as against where the situs of expenditure is. Your lordship, this is because the purpose of interpretation has to be taken into consideration. Literal interpretation clearly gives rise to an absurdity because it results in a in an interpretation whereby any expenditure that has been incurred abroad,
you're able to turn around 180 degrees on the same point. Not bad. That's all.
Thank you so much, Lordship.
Humorously, I can say one thing without naming a learned senior counsel who started arguing in the Supreme Court one day, arguing for the other side. After a long time, only the other day, the junior then pulled us back and said, "Sir, we are appearing." Then the next word he said was, "My lord, these are the things which the other side which you say. Now I am going to say." You know, both of you know very well who the person was. Good.
More than anything else, it's a pleasure to have been with you, sir. He's a retired judge. He's heading a tribunal. He has, within the 1.5 hours, he has read it from the first page to the last page. Arvind, and he's asking you questions. See, this is law is a continuous education. That's the message you should always have. There is no retirement.
For reading. All the best to all of you. Because we
are amazed, sir. We are really amazed to be part of you, sir. It's a pleasure to have, and it's a pleasure to have seen all of you. Wonderful job.
Thanks,
thank you very much, judges.
Yes.
Thank you very much, judges, for such an interactive and interviewing session. It was an absolute honor to witness this. If the judges have no further queries, the participants will be sent to be in the waiting room while the judges deliberate.
Yes.
Are there any queries, judges?
No.
Thank you, judges. I request everyone to join the valedictory ceremony after 10 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yes.
Greetings and a very good evening to everyone present here. Following 2 days of a committed and an extremely impassioned moot court competition, we are here now for the valediction of the 17th edition of India's most prestigious Nani Palkhiwala Memorial National Tax Moot Court Competition 2021, hosted by Sastra Deemed University. In all humbleness, I am tremendously delighted to have you all here. I take this opportunity to extend my sincere and heartfelt welcome to everyone gathered here for the grand valedictory ceremony. Proceeding with the ceremony, I invite our co-convener, Siranjeevi Sarva Ishwaran, to deliver the welcome address.
My warmest greetings to everyone present here. It is important at this juncture to start off this ceremony with a quote by Sri Nani Palkhiwalaji. You may not believe in a fate which overtakes men, however they act, but you have to believe in a fate which overtakes men unless they act. This paints a picture of who Nani Palkhiwalaji was. He was an individual who worked tirelessly to advance the cause of those around him. He was an individual who worked tirelessly to advance his own knowledge and his pursuit towards law. And most importantly, he was a man who never gave up. Commemorating that individual are three judges here before us. Before us right now are Honorable Justice B. Rajendran, former Madras High Court judge and the current chairperson of the TN Real Estate Appellate Tribunal. And our very own Sri N. Venkatraman sir, senior advocate and currently the additional Solicitor General of India attached to the Supreme Court. And again, one of our very well-known patrons of the university, Sri Arvind Pandian, sir, who, aside from being a senior counsel, has served as the additional advocate general of India, of Tamil Nadu. Keeping this bench in mind, it's also important to understand the kind of individuals who supported us through this endeavor. First, let me extend my gratitude and welcome our Honorable Chancellor, sir, who has given us every ounce of support that we need in order to make this occasion a grand success. Our very own Vice Chancellor Sri Vaidya Subramaniam sir, who has always graced us with his knowledge on the and his passion for law, as well as events of such magnitude. Our Dean of Planning and Development Sri Swaminathan sir, our Registrar sir, along with our Dean of School of Law Dr. Pujari Ravishekar Raju, and all our faculty coordinators, including Dr. Sanjit S., Mrs. Gomati, and Ms. Vijayabharati, without whom none of this would have been possible. But most importantly, I'd like to start off by stating that I welcome the core committee and the student coordinators and the student volunteers who made this event the event that it has today. Over the course of the last 6 months, they worked tirelessly to advance every single queries that teams have had to ensure that no individual event upon this particular moot went by unnoticed, made sure there were no hitches whatsoever, and made the task of me as the convener, co-convener, and Sarada as the convener way much easier. I welcome them. Also, would like to welcome the graces of the Nani Palkhivala Trust for placing faith in us to host this particular moot. And I'm grateful to state that we have indeed upheld the trust over the past few years and hope that we'll continue to do so over the course of the next few years as well. Then I'd like to welcome the individuals who have made this possible as a part of Lakshmi Kumar and Sridharan Associates, who have supplied the moot proposition today, as well as the various bench memorials, arguments, citations, etc., which has made the task of us managing the moot, as well as made the task of judging the moot, I hope, way much more interesting by presenting a proposition that is way much enthralling and inciting to the mind of a legal luminary. I'd like to again thank, most importantly, the participants of today's moot, without whom none of this would have been possible, because they made sure that they raised the prestige of this moot to higher and higher levels through the way in which they've argued, through the way in which they presented their arguments before this bench today, as well as all the arguments that the teams have presented over the course of the past 2 days. With that, I, on behalf of the management of Sastra Deemed to Be University, welcome you all to the valedictory function of the 17th Nani Palkhivala Memorial National Taxation Virtual Moot Court Competition of 2021. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarva. Now, I humbly request our retired Honorable Justice Shri B. Rajendran, Chairman of the Real Estate Appellate Tribunal and former Judge of Madras High Court, to deliver the valedictory address.
The Vice Chancellor of the University, Vedkot from Ms. Vaidya, co-convener, the former Additional Advocate General Mr. Venkatramani, my good friend Arvind Pandian, former Additional Advocate General, the coordinators of this event, and the participants, and one and all. Good evening to one and all of you. Really, today, I feel very humble, at the same time, very enjoyable, for two reasons. The students who have made their submissions were par at ease, and their excellent performance equal that of any senior counsel would have argued in a final hearing cases. I would proudly say the students have started their way, the participation in such a very way, well-planned way, they have read it. We are now in the valedictory function. I feel this moot court competition is really one thing which makes a good lawyer right from the beginning, from the college level. I've seen at least many moot competitions for the past so many years, and every year when I see, the team goes one step further. The team advances in the way they have preparation. The team does in a different way. This is what I'm able to see. Wonderful preparations. And the Nani Palkhivala Foundation, when it is doing this good work, coupled with Sastra University, which is, of course, the one of the best colleges in this area, which has been doing very good to the students, have been making the students realize, understand, learn, and come out with a good thing at the beginning itself. Today, all the three judges, when we were discussing off camera, we were at one thing very, very clear. The performance, when it to be judged, it's a difficult one. They have done very well. At the same time, even one question, our additional advocate general put a very wonderful thing. He said, ask the participants to switch over. Suddenly he said, you will now argue for the other side, and you will know, one of you will argue for the other side. And a remarkable thing happened. The person who argued this side turned out to be the opponent, and the other opponent becomes the opponent. At a short notice, when they are able to do this, I said, this is the way a moot competition has to be done. And that is why it extracts the inner strength of a student, which will ultimately become the one thing which can happen before the court. Because in the court, he may be asked so many questions by the judges. At that point, you should not be perplexed. So immediately you should be able to answer. The answer should be simultaneous. At the same time, it should be correct, proper. It should be known very well. For which a good preparation, that is more important. As a trial lawyer, I would say I started my practice in Trichy as a trial lawyer in the Municipal Court. Then I slowly came upon up to the level of the High Court, then up to Supreme Court. We have practiced. But the point there is, if you started as a trial lawyer, you come in to know the nuances of law from the lowest point, where actually my father used to say he was also a lawyer. He had good draft, astute drafting of a plaint, which is ultimately the result by way of a judgment of the High Court. The base of the judgment is a plaint which has been prepared in the Mufassal Court. It might be the Mufassal Court, even though the Supreme Court at one point said the Mufassal drafting may not be so astute, so clear. But the point which has been raised ultimately is answered by the Supreme Court. Therefore, you start there. My only advice to the children is you start at least for some time as a trial lawyer, either in the civil side or in the criminal side, so to understand the nuances of law. At the same, I'm very happy to participate along with two very good judges who are my benchmates today. Wonderful performance of the students here, and lovely to see them approbate and reprobate. That is very important. We have seen only advocates arguing one side, the students arguing one side. Today we have seen a different mode where we can see both approbate and reprobate by the very same person. And that is why every year the moot competition of Sastra University attracts more attraction, more number of participants, and more jubilant, enthusiastic students coming into the picture, which ultimately paves the way for their upcoming as a good lawyer. To be a good lawyer, you must have a clear thinking. To be a good lawyer, you should be a reader. To be a good lawyer, you should be thinking not only about your case, you should think about your opponent's case. They used to say, in the written, the plaint when its court is filed, the Sarastar returns it on some notes why it should not be done. Those days they would say, take the original plaint, see what is the return. Your defense lies there. That's why when the other person argues, you get a point. At the same time, utilize it for them in a way which can be better used in that way. So I wish all the participants a wonderful success. It is not mere the prize distribution. It's not the mere where you get the prize. The very participation makes you perfect. So you should be happy to have participated. That's why I said all the participants are wishing you all the good. And I thank the Sastra University and Vaidya and his father for having invited me for this function to be with you on this day, and wishing the college every success in the years to come. Much more laurels to be got from this college by the students and appreciate students. And thank you for the judges for the nice assistance which they gave me. Thank you, everyone, one and all of you.
Thank you, sir. Now, with great honor, I'd like to invite Sri N. Venkatraman, Additional Solicitor General of India and Senior Advocate, to enrich this gathering with his inspiring words.
Namaste. Humble pranams to Sitaraman sir, Dr. Vaidya, Dr. Swaminathan, Dr. Ravishekar Raju sir, and Sanjit sir. Dear children, the best way to remember Naniji is to remember him this way by conducting a moot. And let me make it clear, I've been saying this in every moot competition every year here during the memorial moot of Naniji. This is one way we connect with Naniji by remembering him and seeking and obtaining his grace and blessings, which is so important for any lawyer or past. He would remain one of the unbeatable counsel, and he would remain as the Pitamaha Bhishma of constitutional law and interpretation in this land for centuries to come. So passionate and yet so dispassionate in his reasoning. He has been so neutral in his contribution and value addition to law, to the jurisprudence of law in this nation. And it's such a pleasure to be part of Honorable Justice, retired Honorable Justice Rajendran Sir's team. And Vaidya yesterday, Dr. Vaidya messaged us yesterday that this is going to be the team. Spontaneously, I gave, it's going to be a finals which is going to vibrate with confidence, with, vibrate with energy, enthusiasm. At 67, he has collected 22 judgments for this MOOC, read them all, besides the memorial in that 1 hour, and grilled the participants left, right, and center. So the message which children have to take back is, at 67, he has not stopped reading. That's the message. Lawyer's job is a never-retiring job, and you can't quit reading and researching. The day you quit, you should hang your coat. That's the simple point. So thank you so much, sir. It's such a pleasure for me and Arvind to be part of your team in this session. Coming to the students, my God, unbeatable. In fact, both teams have to be declared the same result, but you still have to choose a winner. And the shades of difference was very marginal. One out of the four articulated like a real lawyer. He had the poise and comfort of a lawyer, and therefore, well, possibly that has, this has possibly influenced the decision-making process for us to decide one as a winner and one as a runner. And when it comes to me personally, I did speak to Dr. Vaidya yesterday and said, I'm just looking for the opportunity, the first best opportunity to come back on stage and address you all in the Shastra Auditorium, waiting for that momentous day post-COVID. It'll be such a pleasure. Half of my term is over. I'm waiting for the balance half to be over so that I spend more time with all the children in Shastra in the years to come. And this mood will always remain in our hearts, very close and very passionate. And thank you, Shastra, for giving me this opportunity. Once again, my namaskarams to all the teaching faculties and all the students. All of you excelled well. Best prayers. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Now, with immense pleasure, I'd like to invite Sri P.H. Arvind Pandian, Senior Advocate, former Additional Advocate General of Tamil Nadu, to enlighten this gathering with his valuable words.
Thank you, Ms. Kala. Good evening, everyone. Honorable Justice Rajendran, former High Court Judge and presently the Chairman of the Real Estate Appellate Tribunal, Mr. N. Venkatraman, the Additional Solicitor General, Mr. Sethuraman, the Chancellor, Mr. Vaidya, the Vice Chancellor, pronounces Mr. Sethuraman, and also to all the faculty led by Mr. Raju. I do miss, as Mr. Venkatraman was saying, to meet in person to say this. First of all, my pranams to Mr. Sethuraman and my good wishes to the university and the students. It always is a different experience when we are in a, it's like saying that when you continuously bowl and you're suddenly called to bat. So in a moot court is the only place where we get a chance to judge, or unless we sit as an arbitrator, how much the pain the judges go through, what Justice B. Rajan goes to almost on a daily basis. We realize the context of this when we judge this. I'm saying this only because completely it was a, not, I can only call it a shade, as Mr. Venkatraman was using, if I may use the term, the difference between the two teams. This has become the standards, I should say, normally now in almost all moots. The level of the youngsters, I shouldn't even use the word students, because it's youngsters. You may be a full-fledged lawyer already. So it is that level of approach on the subject, the grasp of the issue, and the beautiful expression of that understanding which you have made. And I would simply call it that when I take back the time and go back 30 years back to sit and think whether I would have been able to do it, I humbly would like to say that none of you would even match us because you all are far above what I was at that point in time. And firstly, with the greatest of the good wishes and respects I have for you, hats off to a wonderful performance today. I'm absolutely sure that many of your other colleagues and other teams would have also performed in that level of, I would say, intensity and intellect alone. It is just that you are blessed by God and you are lucky enough to come to the finals. Let's put it that way. And also congratulate all the other participants in this MOOT. Nani Palkiwala MOOT, the greatest man this country could have produced on in the legal field and as a human being for this sort of soil. One quote which always strikes to me is, he said beautifully, we Indians are all individually intelligent but collectively foolish. In whatever context, he meant that we have to kind of understand it on a going basis, depending on our actions vis-a-vis towards our society and towards our country. Are we individualistic or collectively trying to prove ourselves foolish? So such a man who, from the taxation side to the constitutional side, being also on the political side up to the ambassador of the United States, he has performed so many roles and a philanthropist. In his name, it is, I would say, a privilege for this university to conduct this moot court on a year-on-year basis. And I just wish that I live to see the 50th one too. Having said that, I finally would like to thank the university as usual for having given me this opportunity to be associated in this event. And I wish both the teams the best of luck for them. This is not the time for giving any kind of advice or any kind of saying in regard to the performance, because it is super exemplary and even the minor things get covered over that. I would like to finally say that, as Mr. Venkatraman and particularly as Justice Rajendran, who said, people who choose litigation and people who choose non-litigation, it's like saying that they are two different games. It's like saying playing a five-day match versus a T20 match. So how do you choose? Once you choose, now in law, which area you choose and what manner you would like to practice, you choose. After that, it requires a lot of grounding and a lot of grinding also to do. Please choose in a way that it matches your personality and your, not just your knowledge. I once again thank the institution and the university for giving me this opportunity. Thank you, one and all. Namaskar.
Thank you, sir. With this, we have come to the most awaited occasion of the ceremony. Ladies and gentlemen, the long wait is over and it's time for results. Without further ado, I request Sri P.H. Arvind Pandian, Senior Advocate and former Additional Advocate General of Tamil Nadu, to announce the result for the best memorial.
The best memorial goes to National Law Institute, University of Bhopal. The memorial code is TC04.
Thank you, sir. Now, I request Sri N. Venkatraman, Additional Solicitor General of India and Senior Advocate, to announce the results for the best researcher and best speaker.
The best researcher goes to TC17, Hrithik Kashyap. And the best speaker goes to TC07, Seshachala S. Joshi. Congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Now, I humbly request retired Honorable Justice Shri B. Rajendran, Chairman of the Real Estate Appellate Tribunal and former Judge, Madras High Court, to announce the winning team and the runners-up for the 17th Nani Palkiwala Memorial National Tax Moot Court Competition 2021.
The final moment has come. The results are coming. Results are awaited, which is anxiously awaited. As everybody accepted, the result was very, very a narrow one. The winner is the respondents here in the department who have appeared for the department. That is TC07. Is it S1? TC07?
Oh, yes, over here.
For the respondent for the department. And yes, the runner-up is for the appellant. The appellant is the second one here. All the four did very well. Then, of course, rightly, the team which got the best speaker award also comes from the winner side. So he made the remarkable change. That slight change made the difference. So wishing all the team who have participated and the winner and the runners all the best in the years to come. Wishing you all the best.
Thank you, sir.
Unanimous decision. It's an unanimous decision. I should say that's very important. All three of us unanimously agreed on this.
Thank you, sir. As announced by our retired Honorable Justice, Shri B. Rajendran, sir, the winners are team representing Symbiosis Law School, Pune, and the runners up are team representing University School of Law and Legal Studies, Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, Delhi. Warmest congratulations to all the winners. As a matter of adding more significance to the India's most prestigious moot court competition, the winners are awarded with a cash prize of rupees 50,000 and the runners are awarded with the cash prize of rupees 25,000. Now, we have come to the end of the ceremony. To mark the same, I invite our convener, Kumari Sharada Darshini, to propose the vote of thanks.
A very warm good evening to one and all present here. It's my privilege and honor to propose this vote of thanks. I extend my sincere gratitude to firstly the honorable judges for this evening, Honorable Justice Shri B. Rajendran, former judge of the Madras High Court, currently the chairperson of Tamil Nadu Real Estate Appellate Tribunal, Shri N. Venkatraman, Additional Solicitor General of India and Senior Advocate, Shri P. H. Arvind Pandian, Senior Advocate and former Additional Advocate General of Tamil Nadu. Thank you, sirs, for your towering presence, your valuable time, and the enormous wealth of experience and knowledge that you brought in judging this competition, and all the deep insights that mark the valedictory address. Thank you so much, sirs. I would also like to express my sincere gratitude to Lakshmi Kumaran and Sridharan attorneys for their continuous support. I would also like to thank the Nani Palkiwala Trust for having confidence in us and allowing us to conduct this prestigious moot court competition year after year. I would also like to thank C. Natarajan Chair for Legal Studies, endowed by Shri N. Venkatraman, Additional Solicitor General of India and Senior Advocate, for supporting this moot. Thank you, sir. I place my utmost gratitude upon our Revered Chancellor, Professor R. Seduraman, sir, our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. S. Vaidyasubramaniam, sir, our Dean Planning and Development, Dr. S. Swaminathan, sir, our Registrar, Dr. R. Chandramouli, sir, and our Dean School of Law, Dr. P. Ravishekar Raju, sir, and the entire Sastra family for their continuing support to make this event a huge success. I would also like to specially thank the IT team of Sastra for making sure that this program runs smoothly without any technical glitches. I would also like to extend my heartfelt gratitude to all the participants from across the country for their sincere participation. Last but not the least, I would also like to thank the entire organizing team of the Nani Palkiwala Moot Court competition. Without their hard work, this moot would not have been possible. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Sharada. Every end of every day is a happy ending if we decide to keep the story alive to get there. On that note, let's commemorate this phenomenal and a noteworthy session of valediction. Thank you very much. Best wishes.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Can we leave?